the white community. The white community is at war. The conservatives are at war with the liberals, the Democrats, and the Republicans. It's the white community that's all up in arms, that's protesting, that's calling for protests and saying 20,000 are going to meet here and 20,000 are going to meet here to oppose the president and his new initiatives, and they end up having 175 or 200 people showing up. The white community is angry, and they, the conservatives and the liberals, are at war with each other. The different political parties are at war with each other. And so rather than see a civil unrest between whites and blacks, I see whites at war with each other. And so it's going to be interesting to watch what happens in our country, watch what happens in our nation, because the whole world is watching this president. The whole world is trying to figure out what direction we're going in. I've heard talks about impeachment, what's going to happen with our president. Also in the city of Boston, we have an election coming up. We have the mayoral election and city council election coming up, and we have Mayor Marty Walsh as an announced candidate. We have Tito Jackson as an announced candidate. We have Mary Franklin as an announced candidate. I do not believe that we have any more that have announced, but there are others who have indicated that they do want to run for mayor. They just have not announced. I had a black pastor come up to me at a meeting, and he indicated that he was going to run for mayor of the city of Boston, but he wanted me to keep it quiet until he made the announcement. So there are more people that are going to be jumping into this mayoral race. And we know that Mayor Marty Walsh has become somewhat of a champion of the immigration issue and saying that Boston is going to be a sanctuary city. I don't really know what that means, how that's going to be defined, but he's being called on by other mayors and governors in other states and other cities to advise as it relates to how does a city become a sanctuary city. So our mayor is on the national platform talking about immigration. I don't know if he's doing this because he's looking for votes from the immigrant population, those who are citizens and who have become naturalized citizens. I don't know if he's looking for those who were undocumented immigrants to turn to their friends and family members who were citizens to say, we need this mayor. This mayor is standing up for us. I was talking to some people who are working with Tito Jackson, and I was asking the question, when is this mayoral race going to take off? When are we going to see and hear from Mary Franklin that the news has refused to cover? I don't understand that, but the news has refused to cover Mary Franklin. She's coming up with a lot of unique initiatives, not just for survivors of homicide, but she's been focusing on the Roxbury Community College issue. She's been focusing on education and the Boston Public Schools. She has a number of great ideas and thoughts that she's actually put out there, but the news has refused to really cover her. They're only covering Mayor Marty Walsh, Tito Jackson. Tito Jackson, Mayor Marty Walsh. And so we have a lot to talk about as it relates to the upcoming election. We've also sent communications to the Boston City councilors, and we have indicated to them that we are going to prepare a report card for all of the Boston City councilors. And this is new, to have a community group, the Boston Black Ministers United for Change. they have come together, we have come together, and put together an outline that we sent to all the Boston City Councilors. And we said to them that we want you to answer these questions, and then once we receive the answers, we're going to tabulate them and then announce to the city what we think, what grade we think these elected officials should receive from us. And right now, we've heard from Michael, City Councilor Michael Flaherty has called, his staff has called and said that they want to understand what it is that we need and what we want. And so they are actually working on the information that we need. Also, we received today from Tito Jackson his annual report. He's given us the work that he's done for the year. So we have two city councilors, and we're waiting for others to send us their communication. Now, if they decide not to send us their information, then we'll simply report to the city that the city councilor has failed to comply and respond to our request for information regarding what they have done for the year in the city, what they have done for their constituents, for the voting constituency, for the citizens of Boston, and especially our at-large city councilors who represent the entire city, will just have to send out a failure report. We'll say that this city councilor has failed to respond and that they have been given an F. They have failed. And so that's what we're preparing to do for those elected officials who do not take what we want to do seriously. And there are a number who do not want to take what we are doing seriously. And we understand this has never been done before. This is unprecedented. This is new. But we're going to do it anyway. We're going to step into this anyway because we believe that the elected officials should be held accountable for receiving a pay raise, running for office, saying to all of us what they are going to do for the city of Boston. And the big question is, yes, they said that this is what they're going to do for the city of Boston, but have they done it? We're again going to say hello to Mr. Frederick Bell, who is watching us on Facebook Live. We appreciate having you here, and we're going to be asking people to share, if they will, to share the post of our being live on the air with their friends on Facebook so that we can increase our audience, increase our numbers, and I'm hoping that many of you will also send the information out so that we can bring in more people to watch and be a part of what we're doing right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network. We're going to go to a musical break, and after that musical break, we're going to be talking about Fox 25 and the news about the future of Roxbury's Reggie Lewis Center. The Fox News says that it's hanging in the balance, and we're going to enter into that. Gloria Ross and Tommy Lee and two others, along with Stephen Vegas and Bob Cedrone, have all commented and saw our post regarding the future of the Roxbury Community Colleges losing the control over the Reggie Lewis Center. And again, it hangs in the balance. So we're very concerned about that. We're very concerned about why the Roxbury Community College would actually lose site control. I want to say it again. The Roxbury Community College has lost the site control of the Reggie Lewis Center. And that, I don't know, that gives me just a lot of concerns. I don't understand how this could have happened. I do not understand how the Roxbury Community College could just lose this. And there's a state agency that might be taking over the Reggie Lewis Center. And my concern is that if they do, Are we going to have the same thing as it relates to the Roxbury Community College? Is the Roxbury Community College going to go back into state receivership? I hope not. That really concerns me, and it really concerns so many of us who are concerned about our community college and concerned about what's happening with the Reggie Lewis Center. I'm going to go right now to a musical selection with CeCe Winans and Whitney Houston, and it's entitled You Can Count on Me. Let's go there right now, and we'll be back in just a few moments.
Count me through thick and thin, a friendship I will never end. When you are weak, I will be strong, helping you to carry on. Call on me, I will be there. Don't be afraid. Please believe me when I say, it's never
count on me. Oh, yes, you can. No, I can't.
You're listening and watching Boston Politics right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV Network. There are a number of stories that I'd like to bring to your attention. One was written by Joyce Farrowborough, and she says, honoring black families whose legacies run deep. As we close out another Black History Month, we've seen a focus on the black family. At this year's not-so-white Oscars, black families are fair like August Wilson's Fences, won Viola Davis a Best Supporting Actress, Actress Oscar, and Moonlight won Best Picture. Here in Boston, an award-worthy event was hosted by City Councilors Ayanna Pressley, Tito Jackson, and Andrea Campbell, most fittingly at the Bruce C. Bowling Municipal Building, honoring the importance of the black family, extended family, and community. Choosing 12 families to be honored from among hundreds of worthy families throughout the black community had to be a difficult task. But the good news is that there will be more families honored next year and beyond, as this will be an annual celebration on February 22nd, will in perpetuity be Black Family Legacy Day in Boston. Among this year's family honorees were, and she names the different families, the proprietors of Nubian Ocean and a strong small business anchor in Dudley Square for 50 years, the Bowling, Owens, King, and Yancey families for decades of public service, the Janies, teachers and education activists, the Guscotts and Cruz family, community developers and managers extraordinaire, the Binos, whose community building includes the work of the late John Bino and Edna Bino, who fought for and won improvements to Orchard Park, and Kevin, a principal at United Housing, the Red family, the Millers, who gave us the 50-year-strong Bay State banner, and the Hicks family and Hicks Auto Body and community staple. Most interesting was the generational contrast between the honorees and the host, three millennial city councilors honoring their connections to family in their own experiences as public servants. Pressley, raised by a strong mother and spectacular Sandy Pressley, inherited the spirit of service from her mother, who worked for the Urban League. Pressley serves as the first African-American woman elected to the city council in its history. Tito spoke lovingly of the Jackson family, who chose him for adoption, and how inspiring it was to grow up on Schuyler Street in Grove Hall, where, in addition to his role model and activist father, Kwaku Jackson, he knew doctors and lawyers and developers and political movers and shakers. Tito now holds the seat once held by one of those neighbors, my late husband, City Councilor Bruce Bowling. One of the most poignant moments of the evening came from Campbell, the second African-American woman elected to the council. When introducing Yawu Miller, she paid tribute to his uncle, Mel Miller, for helping her see the strengths her father was able to give her despite his involvement in the criminal world. For more than 100 who attended, this was a joyous celebration of the spirit of resilience and enduring legacy of the black family. And I want to say congratulations to all of those black families that were honored. The honor was well-deserved, and I thank Joyce Farrowborough Bowling for writing this story and actually bringing it to our attention. I'd like to go to another story that we're going to be talking about throughout the evening, and it comes out of Fox 25 News, so let's bring this up, and I hope that you will listen to this and comment. Our phone number, if you want to call in tonight, is 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685. One more time, 617-282-0685. And this story was reported on by Crystal Haynes, and she is a reporter for Fox News. She's a black reporter, African-American, for Fox News, and we're actually getting to know more about her and also the quality of her work, and I'm hoping that we'll be able to have her into the studio more. She's been in the studio. To Linda Parker, who's also watching us on Facebook Live, thanks for tuning in. And let's go to see if we can pick up this story and hear it live. Again, Fox 25 story about the Reggie Lewis Center. Let's see if we can get this story to run.
Roxbury Community College and give it to a state-appointed board.
Our Crystal Haynes has more on the concern that these changes may affect the entire neighborhood and thousands of student-athletes.
Roll up their sleeves and fight the great battles.
Just a few years after President Obama rallied for local Democrats here, it's a rumble in Roxbury over the leadership of the Reggie Lewis Track and Athletic Complex.
And we're prepared to stand to fight for our college.
After at least two state audits, an attorney general's investigation, and the controversial dismissal of its longtime director, local lawmakers have filed a bill that would take oversight of the center from Roxbury Community College and give it to an independent state board.
And we think that it's more incompetent of having more of a voice from the community.
Representative Russell Holmes is one of the sponsors of the bill. He tells me members of the community, as well as the Massachusetts State Track Coaches Association, asked for an independent body to step in after their claims of mismanaged funds. Holmes tells me up until this weekend, there was even a proposal to have UMass Boston take over operations of the center.
We don't want to do is weaken ROCC as a college, so taking Reggie Lewis Center from ROCC is certainly not going to be on the board anymore.
Community activists and friends of ROCC spokesman Siddiqui Cambon tells me they don't want ROCC administration to be in charge of the Reggie Lewis Center, but they don't want an outside government body to take over either. They'd rather see President Valerie Roberson fired.
We envision that as being the first step of taking the Reggie Lewis away from our community.
The Track Coaches Association says that this move simply is the right thing to do given years of mismanagement by RCC. I did reach out to their president, Valerie Roberson, and have not heard back yet. Reporting here in Roxbury, I'm Crystal Haynes. Back to you.
Well, that's Crystal Haynes talking about the Reggie Lewis Center, the future of the Reggie Lewis Center, and it looks bleak. I'm concerned about us as a community losing the Reggie Lewis Track and Athletic Center. And Reggie Lewis's wife, Donna, actually came to a meeting at the Reggie Lewis Center. It was a meeting of the Board of Trustees of the Roxbury Community College, and she pleaded with the college and she pleaded with the community to not allow her husband's legacy around this Reggie Lewis Track and Athletic Center to go into receivership, to go to the state, to be controlled by a committee from the state. She wanted it to stay with the college, somehow to stay with the community. I don't know what the answer is. I don't know all that's going on, but it's a news story that's worthy of us as a radio station to follow it. We should not, again, we should not lose the Reggie Lewis Center. It's too important. Again, it's too important for the black community. So if we can lose the Reggie Lewis Center, can't we also lose the Roxbury Community College? If we lose the Roxbury Community College and the Reggie Lewis Center, can't we also lose the Madison Park High School? If we lose the Madison Park High School and the Roxbury Community College and the Reggie Lewis Center, won't the developers be able to take the property and do something to develop that whole area that will not be in our best interest? Let me say it again. That will not be in the community's best interest if we lose all of that parcel of land down in the lower part of Roxbury. Now, there have been a lot of comments by Siddiqui Cambone, as he's been leading the charge for the community to look at and to examine the Reggie Lewis Center and the Roxbury Community College. He wants the president of the Roxbury Community College fired. And the president's name is Valerie Robinson. Again, he says that she needs to be fired. He's citing mismanagement of the college. That's what the Siddiqui is saying. There are allegations coming from many different segments of the community regarding her leadership. I don't know, but we have made an attempt to speak to the president of the Roxbury Community College, and she has declined to comment. So all we can hear is the comment from Siddiqui Cambone, a spokesperson for Friends of the Roxbury Community College, said they don't want the community college's administration to be in charge of the Reggie Lewis Center, but they don't want an outside government body to take it over. So Siddiqui is saying it shouldn't go to the state. It shouldn't be with the Roxbury Community College. So who should take over the management of the Reggie Lewis Center? I don't know. But it's something that we as a community need to start talking about. It's something that we need to engage each other on. We cannot, we should not lose the control as a community of such a valuable asset. Do you know that there are athletic groups from across the state that are booking the Reggie Lewis Track Center? They're booking it for their events. And if we lose that, it could be significant revenue, I believe, if it was managed differently. But if we lose it, and we lose the Roxbury Community College, and we lose Madison Park High School, the developers would have a field day in the black community. That will be one major takeover in the black community. We cannot, we should not let this happen. We cannot let the Reggie Lewis Track Center go down in flames because we as a community will not come together and address this issue and find a way of working together to keep the Reggie Lewis Center. There's a story that I'd like to read. State legislators are looking to take control of the Reggie Lewis Track and Athletic Center away from the Roxbury Community College after a series of high-profile controversies last year, a move one state track official says is long overdue. Quote, they were supposed to be turnkey people who protected the vision of the facility, and they failed to do that. They failed miserably, said Rick Cates, assistant executive director of the Massachusetts State Track Coaches Association. So they are also pushing this to happen. I am concerned that we as a community, from elected officials all the way to community groups, are not coming together to do something to save the Reggie Lewis Center. Mark Worrell is watching us, and hello, Mark. Thanks for being a part of our broadcast tonight. I appreciate you watching and appreciate you listening. If you want to call in and comment about the Reggie Lewis Center, the controversy that's swirling and growing, it's at the state level now. They're talking about mismanagement of the Reggie Lewis Center. I don't know about the truth and veracity of those statements, but I do know that it's that the center is in trouble. I do know that UMass was going to consider taking the Reggie Lewis Center and that UMass was going to control it. I don't know if that would be a good idea or a bad idea. I just don't know. But it's something that we really need to put our heads together on. We as the black community have to stop losing valuable assets in the community. We have to stop losing valuable property in the community. We've got to do something about coming together, putting our hearts and minds together, and helping to keep the Reggie Lewis Track Center. Go ahead, caller. You're live on the air.
Good morning. I mean, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing well. I'm very concerned about this story that continues to be in the front page of the newspaper and televisions in Boston.
About the Reggie Lewis and what's going on?
Yeah.
I know. My sister was at one of the meetings last night, and they talked about that they're supposed to be, like, turning it over.
Right. So, there's a story that came out today on Fox News, and I just aired it a few minutes ago, and they were talking about how Russell Holmes is one of the lead politicians who is sponsoring the legislation for it to be taken over by the state. A small committee would come together and take it over. But here's my concern, and I'm glad you raised it this morning. If we lose the Reggie Lewis track and field center, if we lose it, and then the controversy swirling around the Roxbury Community College. So let's say we lose that. And then let's say we lose the Madison Park High School. Look at all of the land that the developers will have to develop in the lower part of Roxbury.
Exactly. And some people believe that that's exactly what they're trying to do. It's funny you mention Russell Holmes because I've just come to the conclusion that he is not for us at all. I'm actually leaving a MMCA meeting that he was at, Mass Minority Contractors Association meeting that he was at. I didn't get a chance to speak to him, but there's so much stuff that's going on. And the fact that they would take the Reggie Lewis away from us, they take the Roxbury Community College away from us, and then they want to shut down Madison Park or even make it a regional school. Yeah. Now, if you think about it, if you look at what they're doing, now all of a sudden they're making all these renovations to Roxbury Community College, you know, fixing the elevator, fixing this, fixing that. They're not doing that for us.
Right.
You know, they're doing this so that their people can come back in, go to the school and have it comfortable for them and have it, you know, beautified for them. It's a $43.9 million project on the inside.
Wow.
You know, and then you see what they're doing over in the parking lot,
right.
And there's no people that look like us on that job over there.
Right,
You think they're doing all that for people who only make $30,000 a year? No.
I share the same sentiment. And there's also something I wanted to call to your attention. So while we're working on saving the parking lot across the street from the church, we were walking through the community putting flyers in at the churches and in the businesses and the community agencies. And we came to the corner of Washington and Dunbar Street. And on the corner of Washington and Dunbar Street, there is another lot that's been being renovated right now. And if you walk up to it, all around the development is a fence, and you can't see through the fence. And the other day, driving into the church, this is two blocks from the church, I saw white people, contractors, driving in. Their cars are going in and going underneath the building while they're renovating. Their cars are not on the street, so that A, you could see the license plates.
Mm-hmm.
Two, if you're not out there watching it, you can't tell if there are any black people working on the project. So I called the transportation department and first asked what's going up across the street.
Yeah.
And they said that it's going to be apartment buildings. And I said, are they going to be affordable? And they said yes. And I said to myself, I don't really know the questions to ask, because affordable for who?
Exactly.
And how do we find out? On the front of the building, there's a sign that has the numbers to call if you want to find out information about the establishment. But how do we find out who the contractor is? And do you ask the question, are there any people of color working at this site?
Well, there's something called the Freedom of Information Act where you can call and get all the you know, who's the contractor, who's the developer. Is it a city project? Do you see anything with the city's information on it? Is it a private...
I'll probably have to go back and take a look at that because there's a sign on the outside and I thought I took a picture, but maybe the picture didn't come out. So I'll go ahead and I'll look at that again because we've got to ask the question. Whenever we see this, we have to ask the question. We cannot. I mean, why would you wrap around the bottom of the building, put all the cars on the inside? What's that about? I've never seen that before. Well, all the cars of the contractors are not on the street. So you can't get the license plates, you know.
That's probably why they're doing it, so you can't see the license plates.
So what happens if we find out that there are no black people working in the black community on apartments on Washington Street in Cobman Square? What do we do?
Well, we have to do what we've been doing. We either have to... we may have to protest. We may have to, get a meeting with these contractors, these developers.
Right.
We've been trying to get Andrea Campbell, whose district I believe this is, to set up a monitoring committee meeting like the one that Tito Jackson has down in Roxbury.
Okay.
Because there's four projects down there that we're monitoring.
Okay.
And we find that when there's community involvement with as far as monitoring the projects, the contractors and developers are more likely to be in compliance.
Okay.
Because they're looking in our face every other week and we're telling them and letting them know that we're not happy with what you all are doing and then you all need to comply.
Okay.
So it's a matter of finding out who it is, and it could be a city project. We don't know.
Okay.
But if it's a city project, it would definitely have some information about the city on that side.
Okay.
Like, you know, this is a city project. And, I mean, I don't understand why they keep building and building and building and developing, 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 because every time something goes up, you know, it's more costly for the people in the community.
Right.
And the people who live here who do not own property, they're the ones that's going to be getting kicked out of here,
right, right. And if they're building apartments, so are we now going to have a greater concern about parking? Because they are now, if you look at Washington Street all around the church, they have signs that say resident parking only. So people are parking their cars on the street because the parking lot's full, and they're now receiving tickets for going into the businesses in the area.
That's horrible because now the businesses are going to lose money because people aren't going to want to come because they can't park.
Right. So that's an issue. That's a concern that I have. I mean, who's planning this? And why are the elected officials, for example, I was saying to Andrea Campbell's office, city councilor, and Russell Holmes, that they said, well, we're going to wait to find out what the community wants, and we're going to support what the community wants. And I said to myself, that's a politician, but a leader, a real leader, will assess the community and know that parking is vital and not wait until they hear from the community. They'll say, this is vital for the community. Even if the community says, we don't know if we want that, people need to provide leadership and go ahead and take the hit and say, we can see a couple years down the road, this community needs parking, even if the community doesn't know it. I said, we need leadership. And they said, well, we're going to wait to hear what the community has to say.
That's just a way of them stalling.
Stalling for what?
Until the property gets built.
That, you know, so this concerns me. And tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, I'm going to have I'm going to be speaking to the city 8 o'clock from the radio station, and I'm going to speak to the city about what's happening, because tomorrow night at the Great Hall, the Cobham Square Neighborhood Council is having their monthly meeting, and the city is coming to give an update as to where they're at on the parking lot. So I'm going to the meeting. I'm not going to say anything, but I'm going to the meeting. I'm just going to sit and be silent and watch them.
Well, you know, Pastor, the stuff that is going on is clearly, and anybody that doesn't realize it, they just, you know, they're living in a fairy land, because we are being gentrified out of this community.
That's what's happening.
That is the bottom line.
Right.
I'm talking about Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan. You know,
right.
Basically, they don't want us here,
right.
So they're making it very uncomfortable for us to live here.
Right.
And so those of us who own homes, you know, we can say, well, you know, they can't put us out. But if you live on a fixed income, like
right.
say you're an elderly person and you live
yeah.
on a fixed income,
yeah.
and they sell the house next to you, and the
yeah.
house sells for $1 million,
yeah.
that means that your taxes are going to go up.
Right.
You know?
Right.
They don't. They, you know, they're planning for 2030. Like, they're in the process of doing a bunch of stuff at Franklin Park that I bet a lot of people don't know.
Right. So here's my concern. When you say things like they're planning for 2030, I've been pushing the city for years to declare a state of emergency regarding the homicides, number one. And I said we need a comprehensive plan to look 10 years or 15 years down the line to see what the city is going to look like and start planning to move in that direction. But the city doesn't want to do it. But as it relates to development and the seaport and the Olympics and other kinds of things, they'll put their time and energy and money into that. But they're not going to put their time and energy and money into saving the lives of our young people. What is wrong with our city? Why do they have it backwards? And why is the mayor of the city wanting to be the champion of the immigrants and not wanting to be the champion of helping to save lives of black people in Boston?
I cannot answer that question. That is a question you're going to have to ask the mayor, because it don't make any type of sense whatsoever.
Right.
Here
right.
we are burying our children every other day. Someone's being shot, stabbed, whatever, you know. Our children's education system is all whack. Did you know that our city councilor, Savvy George, doesn't even have a teaching certificate, but yet she taught for 10 years?
Wow.
I mean, they don't care. That's it. They just don't care. And we have to stand up and keep being the rebel rousers, keep making the noise, you know.
Right.
Keep, you know, we have to. This is just what we have to do. Because if we don't give them any opposition, they're just going to, you know, just sweep us out of here.
Well,
and I don't understand the mayor. I really don't understand why he don't see the violence that is going on as a higher priority than what's going on with the immigrants. I mean, that is important, yes. But also, what about our children that we're losing? They're not important.
Right, right.
I don't know what the mayor's thinking, to be honest with you.
Well, we're going to have to keep raising the issue and keep raising the issue so that we can put pressure on the mayor. Tisha Gilead, who is watching us on Facebook Live, said, Pastor Bruce, I reached out to the city councilor at large, Ayanna Presley and Tito Jackson, as soon as I got word of it. Not enough to pray. We have to speak up. I will continue to keep you, your church, Cobham Square residents, and black businesses, and myself in prayer. And I appreciate the fact that people on Facebook Live are chiming in and saying they want to stand with us and support us. So tomorrow, I'm putting it all out there tomorrow. Tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock, you will not want to miss what I'm going to say on tomorrow.
I know.
All right, my sister. Did you have any announcements that you wanted to make before I let you go?
I want to talk about the our affordable housing. Not affordable housing. I got affordable housing on the brain. Our first-time home buying class that we're having the 11th and the 18th of March.
Okay.
So I'm asking people to call the Black Economic Justice Institute at 908-800-2354 and register to take this class, because we have got to come up with ways that we can start purchasing some of this property and coming together and doing that. And also on the 16th, The street teams is the Blue Hill Planning Commission meeting at 61 Columbia Road. Mm-hmm. And on the 16th, there's going to be another meeting at the Roxbury Community College around the job, the 43-point-something million dollars that they're doing. So we're looking for MBEs and WBEs to come out so that they can find out exactly how they go about bidding on this project.
Well, okay, two things. One thing that I was thinking while you were talking is that question is, when can 1,000 people go to City Hall and pray in the mayor's lobby? 1,000, number one. And number two, this coming Sunday, starting at 7 p.m., we're going to have 14 hours of prayer here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV. And we wanted to ask you to be one of the people. We have people from outside of the city and in the city that will be coming into the studio starting at 7 p.m., and they have 30 minutes to stand before the microphone. They're going to be standing up at the podium, and they're going to be leading in prayer or reading scripture or singing or whatever, but they have 30 minutes to lead the city in prayer. We're going to broadcast it live starting at 7 p.m., going all the way until Monday morning at what time? At 9 a.m. So I'm going to send you a list of all the open slots and ask if you will choose one so that you can come and be a part of this event.
All right. Well, thank you. I appreciate the invitation.
Okay.
And I will see you Thursday.
Okay.
You know we're going to be together all day Thursday?
Yes, I know. I'm going to get ready.
All right, Pastor. Okay. Talk to you soon. Tell Pastor Hobbs I said hello.
Okay, we'll do.
Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye. We're going to go to station ID, and after station ID, we're going to come back with more from you right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network. Don't go anywhere. We want to hear from you.
In New England. The views and opinions expressed by the following paid program are those of the program producers, and they do not reflect the views and opinion of Boston Praise Radio, its staff, or management.
Hi, I'm Minister Franklin Hobbs, and I'm inviting you to join us on Healing Our Lands live broadcast heard on the Boston Praise Radio Network Monday through Friday, 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Be blessed.
You can listen to Boston Praise Radio and TV on audio now. Just dial 712-432-4402. That's 712-432-4402. You will be able to hear us right on your cell phone without any software. That's audio now and dial 712-432-4402.
Hi, this is Mike D of the UA7 Gospel Countdown, Urban America's 7 biggest current songs and more. Join us in fellowship with our broadcast on www.bostonpraiseradio.tv, Roku TV, WRCA 1330 AM Radio, and WBPG 102.9 FM Radio. These TV and radio networks are all coming out of Boston. Radio and TV that cares about Boston and beyond. This is yours sincerely, Mike D. of the UA7 Gospel Countdown. Tune in and be blessed.
If you want to broadcast on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network, please call us at 617-282-0685. That's 617-282-0685. You can broadcast on the internet, Roku TV, or our brand new station, WBPG LP 102.9 FM Radio. Again, call us at 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685.
For Sister Gilead, I will talk to Priscilla about posting the information about the home buying class on Facebook. I believe she can do that, and I believe she still might be listening. So I'll talk to her about posting that information. That's a good point. Reverend Betty Collier on Facebook Live said she would love to be a part of the all-night prayer and worship, and I will talk to you about that, Reverend Collier, shortly. And I'm asking the question, when can 1,000 people go to City Hall and pray in the mayor's lobby? We want him to feel the pressure of a community that wants the city to do their part in saving our youth. We'll do our part, but we want the city to do their part. After all, we're paying the elected officials to work with us and on our behalf. I believe that they should be doing much more than they're doing. 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685. I'm Pastor Bruce Wall. We're live in the studio. We're going to be here until 9 o'clock, and then we're going to air the president's speech. And after he speaks, we're going to talk about what he has said. So we want you to stay with us. I want black people to be engaged. I want black people to stay up. I want you to be a part of this. I do not want you to let this opportunity go by for us to be able to talk about what is happening in our city, what's happening in our nation, what's happening in our world, and comment about where the president is taking our country, just like we need to be active about where our city is going. Sister Gilead said, awesome, thank you, so I can pass this information along. Yes, we will actually work on that. We're going to go to a song right now, and when I come back, we're going to talk more. And Siddiqui Cambone will be calling in at 8 o'clock. He's going to be talking to us, and we're going to continue to talk more about the Roxbury Community College, also the Reggie Lewis Center, the property across the street, and a number of different issues as we are Boston Politics, learning how to talk politically. We're learning how to talk politically in the city of Boston. We're learning how to do this. And we want you to also learn how to talk politically, because we need to take this city by storm. I'm going to say it again. We need to take this city by storm. Let's go and listen to, we're going to listen to Charles Jenkins. And Charles Jenkins has a great song that talks about declaring war. We are declaring war in the city of Boston. We are declaring war, and we want you to go to war with us right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network. I'm serious. It is time for us to act and challenge our city to stop playing games.
Might as well put your hands together. I got joy in my soul. God is in control. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back, 'cause this means war. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back, 'cause this means war.
You know what? I think I need to play that again because Charles Jenkins didn't know what he was doing when he wrote this song. I don't think he did. He's saying, this means war. And I think that we need to walk into a warfare with those in our community and those in our city that are trying to politically take over and silence us and keep us from being engaged and keep us from being involved. We have to fight back. Again, we have to fight back. 617-282-0685 is our number. 617-282-0685. We are going to continue to stay focused on this. Again, Mother Collier is saying she'd love to be a part of the all-night prayer and worship. You are welcome to be a part, and we'll give you some information about the all-night prayer. It's going to be this coming Sunday. This coming Sunday, we start at 7 p.m., and we're going to go all night into Monday morning at 9 a.m. We are going to pray for our city. We're going to pray for what's happening in our country. We're going to pray for different pockets around the world. As believers, we're going to pray. But we're not going to pray behind the four walls of the church. We're going to do it live on our radio and television network so people all over the world, will be able to tune in and listen to what God is going to do and what God is going to say through the prophets and evangelists and the preachers and the teachers. All of them are going to be here. We've got people calling in from around the country who are going to be a part of this, and I'm looking forward to having a response after we pray. I'm believing God to move in our midst. After we pray, I'm believing God to move in our midst. And I'm hoping that many of you will let people know what we're going to do right here on the Boston Praise Radio and TV network. Let's go back to that song because I need that in my spirit. I need that song to come into my spirit, to come into my heart, and prepare me for the war that's about to take place in this town.
Might as well put your hands together. Control. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back. Cause this means war.
lying down.
This means war.
Said this means.
This means war. This means war.
5, 6, 7, 8.
Charles Jenkins, great, great song. It pumps up the blood and gets you ready for the war that you have to step into. What are the other questions that I'd like to ask the listening audience today for those of you who want to engage and talk? 617-282-0654. 617-282-0654. 0685. For those of you who have been watching us for the years, for a number of years now, you know that we're very serious about what we're doing. We're not playing about what we're doing. And we want to enter in to having serious discussions with members of people in the black community. And too many times, though, too many times, people do not want to walk into having a serious conversation. Too many times, people just want to skirt the issue, not call names, that just want to hear about what's going on, but they don't want to do anything about it. And they leave it to a few people to be engaged. They leave it to a few people to be involved, to pick up the gauntlet, to pick up the battle, to be engaged in the battle. But they don't want to be engaged. And they want other people to fight on their behalf. And that's what's killing us. That's what's hurting us. The fact that we will not come together and have serious dialogue and discussion about how we can and should move forward as a community. I'm going to say it again. We don't want to come together. We won't come together and have serious dialogue about how we can and should come together as a community. We are being picked off. I'm going to say it again. We are being picked off by individuals in the community that are working on behalf of very powerful people to sidetrack us. Very powerful people want to sidetrack us. And when are we going to recognize that what was done to us as black people in this country many, many years ago, it is still taking place now? I used to think that the elected officials were going to be seriously engaged in the community, but now I understand that that's not going to happen. Let's go to the phone lines.